Good morning. Welcome. Glad to have you out today. And a little bit cooler, but another nice weekend. And I hope that you're having a good weekend. Just a reminder of a few announcements that we're going to go to lunch after our service today. And you're more than welcome to go with us. We're going to meet at 11:30 over at the Europa Cafe Bistro on 91 and close to Bob Evans there in that little plaza. And some of you have signed up to go, but if you didn't, you're still more than welcome to come. I stopped in there yesterday or the day before. What a quaint little place. I've never actually eaten there, but I'm looking forward to it. So you're more than welcome to join us on that. So we are going to remind you of another opportunity to join us on Wednesday nights. We had a good jump start on a new study called Forged in Fire. It's based upon a passage in 1 Peter chapter 1 that talks about our faith being refined. And it's the idea of the purity of our faith has to go through the fire of testing and adjustments and constructing and deconstructing and reconstructing over the course of a lifetime. And so we're going to be touching upon some topics that I think some people have trouble with in terms of the amount of violence that you find in the scriptures. What do we do with that? How do we deconstruct that in light of the teachings of Jesus? Some different things that I think are pertinent. So if you want to be on our email list and get the handout that I send out every week, just let me know. I'll be glad to do that. And if you want to check that out on YouTube, it's available for you each week. I upload that right after we're done on Wednesday night. So those are the couple of things that we're reminding you of. And again, our brunch will start at 11:30 over at our restaurant spot. So we are finally winding down this trilogy of sermon series, Deeper, Wider, Higher, and we are on the last one, Higher. And what we're doing is we're talking about some of the Beatitudes that are found in Matthew chapter 5. And we have been diving deeper into stories. They help inform us. We are exploring wider with questions because they enlarge us. And now we finish off this calendar year with climbing higher through beatitude ethics, because that is what enables human flourishing. So having said that, in Matthew chapter 5, we have 8 beatitudes, and we looked at the first one last week, which says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Today, we're going to talk a little bit about, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." Now, I found kind of an updated understanding of the Beatitudes. I'm going to unfold those for you one at a time each week. And here's what the first two look like. Blessed are those who are poor at being spiritual, for the kingdom of heaven is well suited for ordinary people. And then, blessed are the depressed who mourn and grieve, for they create space to encounter comfort from another. The idea of mourning and the idea of finding comfort in the midst of our sorrow and grief is a common theme throughout the scripture. But one particular passage that stands out to me is this one that's found in 2 Corinthians 1, verses 3 through 5. The Apostle Paul is writing to the Corinthian congregation. Corinth is in modern-day Greece. And what we find him saying is, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. For just as we share abundantly in the sufferings of Christ, so also our comfort abounds through Christ." I'm going to ask you to stand with me. I'm going to open up with prayer. And then we introduced a song last week that we're going to do again. It's called "The Kingdom is Yours." Join me in prayer, please. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity that is ours to gather on this Lord's Day. Thank you that we can take time to contemplate, meditate, to listen, and to learn. Thank you that we can praise you and pray to you and find your prompting and your leading and your Spirit enabling us to find help and hope and healing in the midst of our days. We do pray for the world in which we observe such horror going on in a couple of hot spots in Russia, Ukraine, and in Israel and in Gaza. We pray for leaders around the world to come to their senses and stop the human bloodshed. We pray for peacemakers and peacekeepers to be able to be heard and to be able to come to the point where we are not the cause of the mourning and the grief and the sorrow that is in the hearts of so many. We do pray, Father, that we might have an understanding of what your kingdom is really like, and that we might have a desire to embrace the ethics that are taught through Jesus our Lord. We do pray like Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen and amen.
Blessed are the ones who do not bear me, all the broken pieces of their heart. Blessed are the tears of all the weary, pouring like a sky of falling stars. Blessed are the ones and ones in mourning, brave enough to show the Lord their scars. Blessed are the hurts that are not hidden, open to the healing touch of God. Kingdom is yours.
Fall, they'll never know defeat.
The kingdom.
seat for a moment, please. In John chapter 11, verse 35, we have the shortest verse in the Bible. It says, Jesus wept. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Jesus wept. The story that this short little verse is found in is the story of a group of friends. It's a story of a brother and two sisters that knew Jesus very intimately. It's the story of these siblings getting the news that the brother is deathly ill. It's the story of Jesus and his disciples being out on the road and teaching in the villages throughout Judea. It's the story of news breaking that Lazarus, his dear friend, passed away. It's the story of Jesus being too late to get there. It's the story of two sisters that are mad that Jesus wasn't there when Lazarus took his last breath. It's the story of both those sisters confronting Jesus with the fact that he was too late. Listen to the text in John chapter 11. It says here, on his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany, the village, was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem. And many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know, he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. And Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she replied. I believe you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come into the world. After Jesus said this, she went back and called her sister Mary to her side. The teacher's here, she said, and he is asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus, who had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews, who had been with Mary in the house comforting her, noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. And Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, see how he loved him. I'm going to stop that story for here for now. These two sisters confronted Jesus because he was not on time. Many times in life, we feel God is not on time, that he lags behind in our prayers and in our desires. And yet, when they go out to meet him, they believe. They believe something is going to happen. They anticipate something that is going to happen. And that's where this next hymn is going. It's an old, old hymn. How many of you know this hymn? I know whom I have believed. Let's stand. We'll sing it together. It's easy to catch on. Well, the Beatitudes make for a better world, and they enhance human flourishing. And last week, we started this series, Climbing Higher. We've talked about blessed are the poor, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And today, we're going to talk about blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. A couple of things to keep in mind about the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes are a section of Scripture in which there's a wide variety of different interpretations. There are some that think that it's primarily spiritual and try to apply spiritual components to it. So, for example, they would say, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven," is talking about those of us who are not worthy of God's kingdom, and we realize that and we repent of our sins. We might call that kind of a spiritual application. But in Jesus' setting, where the entire population that followed his earthly ministry were primarily poor economically, the Beatitudes also have this physical component of interpretation that talks about the physical needs of people that are on the margins, people that economically need help. And yet, for the type of Beatitudes like we're going to talk about today, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted, there's kind of a psychological and emotional component to it. That when we are going through the throes of grief, how is it that we can find hope, and how is it that we can find healing when we lost someone or something very dear to us? And I don't think you need to choose one of these. I think that's the mistake that we often make in the teachings of Jesus. We think he meant only one thing. In Jesus' parables, in Jesus' teaching, many times it's like a diamond that has a multifacet to it. And if you look at the light that comes through particular angles of that diamond, what you'll find is that there are different applications depending on who we are and where we are in the course of our life. So keep these in mind, that the Beatitudes can have a physical, psychological, emotional, and spiritual component to it. There are only two records of the Beatitudes. One is found in the book of Matthew. That's the text that we are looking at in these days. And the other one is in the Gospel of Luke, which has a different flavor to it. And you're going to see that in a slide I'm going to give to you in a moment. However, we did say in the Gospel of Matthew, there's kind of a base camp that we need to keep in mind in climbing toward these Beatitudes. Number one is this: it is a connection to the kingdom of heaven. Now, the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God that's found in the other Gospels are kind of synonyms, and it's the idea of God's rule and reign upon the earth. Don't think of the kingdom of heaven as after you die, you go to heaven. It includes that, obviously, but we cut ourselves short a little bit if that's the only way we apply it. The first application is God's work and rule in the world in which we live. Secondly, in Matthew's gospel, it's very intentional that the Beatitudes are connected to Jesus as Moses is connected to the giving of the law back in the book of Exodus. In fact, some of the imagery is the same. Jesus goes up upon a mount, and he gives this new law. You have heard it said, but I say to you, that comes later in the Sermon on the Mount. And what we find is some of the visual elements of it is representative of when Moses went up to Mount Sinai and brought the law down. So there's Moses that's kind of in the back of the mind of Matthew as he's writing this. Thirdly, it is connected to human flourishing. We talked a little bit about blessed being a word that sometimes is translated happy. Happy are those who mourn. And a lot of times you go, what? How does that work, right? It is better to think of blessed as flourishing, as the idea of someone able to overcome those predicaments that we often find ourselves in. So sometimes that includes happiness, but sometimes it includes peace without the happiness. You know, some circumstances are not happy or joyful by any means, but can we flourish in the midst of those circumstances? And I think that's a better rendering or idea of the Beatitudes in Matthew's gospel. And then finally, number four, it is a counterintuitive announcement of the good news to all the wrong people. You remember last week, I took the Beatitudes, I took the slide, I turned it upside down, and it was difficult to read because that's what the people are hearing. All the people that are blessed, all the people that are fortunate, all the people that have the potential to flourish are all the wrong people, okay? They're not the people that are on the top. They're not the people that already have enough. They're not the people that know where their gold and their silver is. These are people that are living day to day. These are people that are pushed to the margins. These are people that are very needy of God's healing touch, physical and emotional and psychological. So with that said, this particular beatitude, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted, has a couple of different elements to it. And the way I would like to look at it this morning is to think about this as an invitation. Do not think of the Beatitudes as kind of for privileged people as a way that they can get more than they already have. Don't think of the Beatitudes like that. And it's not a pyramid scheme. This is not a way to level up your spirituality. Rather, it's good news about those who feel forgotten and left out. So how does that pertain to what this particular beatitude is about? Is he simply talking about a group of people who have lost loved ones? Yes, it includes that. But it is also something that applies to a community as well. And so this particular beatitude has an individual application and a community application. And it's not just related to losing someone close that you dearly love. You know, we can mourn, our heart can ache for a variety of different things that we see. I don't know anyone in Israel. I don't know anyone in Gaza. I don't know anyone in Russia. I don't know anyone in Ukraine. But our hearts can mourn for the loss of life. Our hearts can mourn that civilians' lives who should be protected under the rules of warfare are losing their life. We can grieve deeply that our world is the way that it is. And so it has individual applications. It also has a collective application as well. Now, remember I said that the Gospel of Matthew and the Gospel of Luke contain the Beatitudes, but they don't number the same, nor do they have the same emphasis. So the eight Beatitudes in Matthew chapter 5 are contrasted with only four Beatitudes in the Gospel of Luke, but there's the addition of four woes, W-O-E, in the Gospel of Luke. Well, why is that? You see, in the Gospel of Luke, Luke is concerned about people that are average, people that are on the margins. And so he adds an element of contrast to four of the Beatitudes. In his account, blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who hunger now, you'll be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. And blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. And then he says, but woe to you who are rich, you've already received your comfort. Woe to you who are well fed now, you will go hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you will mourn and weep. And woe to you who, when everyone speaks well of you, for this is how their ancestors treated the false prophets. Now, in the case of the Beatitude we're looking at today, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. The woe contrast is right here. Blessed are you who laugh now, for you will mourn and weep. So what is Luke doing? He is kind of giving an element of justice. There's coming justice for those that especially are poor and hungry and weeping and hated. Okay? So that's kind of the contrast between the two writers on how they use the Beatitudes. I don't think Jesus taught this only one time. A good teacher will reuse the same material in different settings. Who knows how many times Jesus gave the Beatitudes? Who knows how many times he taught some of the same things that are found in the Sermon on the Mount? So, blessed are those that mourn. How are we to look at this particular Beatitude? If we take it individually, it might be that moment in time where you had to say goodbye to someone you dearly love. It is someone that you couldn't let go of. It was someone that gave you meaning and purpose in life. It is someone that somehow held your heart in their hands. And it is those individuals that maybe have gone too soon, gone prematurely. It is those type of situations that often brings about a lot of bitterness, doesn't it? It's those type of situations that often cause people to lose faith in God. You kind of get that feeling just a little bit in the text I read to you earlier when Mary and Martha come out to Jesus, right? They're very disappointed that he's doing miracles for everyone else, and here is a family that's part of his inner circle, and he wasn't there to intervene, right? And so it's almost as if they're ready to give up, but they choose to hear his comforting words, "I am the resurrection and the life." And in a moment, I'll read for you the rest of that paragraph. Collectively, what we find is sometimes mourning becomes a survival skill, doesn't it? You got to get it out, because if you don't, it's going to eat you up inside, right? It has damaging effects upon us internally. Well, I came across a very vivid image. In the book of Jeremiah, he is called the weeping prophet, which is an interesting designation because he goes through a lot of mourning. He looks at his own people being taken captive into Babylon, and they're going to be in exile, and he knows that they're going to be in exile for an entire generation. And what we find is that he says in chapter 9, verse 21 of Jeremiah, "Death has climbed through our windows and has entered our fortresses." Isn't that a vivid imagery? That death was outside and somehow they pried open the window and they came rushing in and overwhelmed us. It's kind of like an invading army, if you will. Well, here's a commonality that we all have. We all share this. Death has entered the tent of all who traverse this terrain called life. None of us get away from that. None of us have the ability to escape saying goodbye to individuals that we dearly love. But there is such a curious dynamic, especially among Christians, how we downplay individuals in mourning. We want to shut them up because we feel uncomfortable, okay? And there's a lot of platitudes. I'll give you a few of them. These are things you should never say, right? Heaven needed another angel. Everything happens for a reason. The person that hears that says, well, if everything happens for a reason, can you give me a reason why this happened to my loved one? Right? You know, when you say that everything happens for a reason, you have placed a seed in someone else's soul that's going to drive them nuts. Because they're going to look for a reason, and sometimes you can't get one. How about this one? When God closes the door, he will open a window. Have you ever heard that one? Yeah, when you open that window, death comes rushing in, just like Jeremiah says, right? No, no. Make sure to keep busy. Time heals all wounds. Oh, we can't be sad because he or she or they are in a better place now. The intention might be well-meaning, but the person that hears that is saying, no, the better place is here with me. Right? Living and dying are part of the cycle of life. We can't escape that. But sometimes it comes unexpectedly, unjustly, violently, and so forth. And our mortality is never a good fit because we always long for life. And sometimes we have time to prepare ourselves for that, and sometimes we don't. But I will say this, that mourning comes at various levels and in various waves. No one gets to say how long mourning is to last in anyone's life. The truth is, we are taught how to acquire things. We are not taught how we lose them. But loss is a part of life, and there comes a point when we can no longer acquire, and we have to let go. And yet within religious circles, being impervious to grief and suffering and pain is often portrayed as a spiritual badge of honor. That needs to stop. That needs to stop. What should I say? How about something simple? I'm so sorry for your loss. It grieves my heart. Pretty easy. Doesn't remove the tension of mourning, but it's honest. This beatitude tells us that Jesus joins himself with those who mourn. Jesus wept. Mourning looks different for everyone. No two people mourn the same way. But there is a connection between mourning and healing. And I think it's related to hope. Here's how the rest of that paragraph goes. Jesus comes to the tomb of Lazarus and he weeps. The Jews say, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, they couldn't keep their mouth shut, right? Couldn't he not have opened the eyes of the blind, have kept this man from dying? Jesus once more was deeply moved. He's weeping. The text doesn't say this, but it alludes to the fact that he emotionally was a wreck. He comes to the tomb. And it was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there for 4 days." I love the way the old King James translation says, no, "he stinketh." The NIV kind of tames that a little bit. No, Jesus says, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this is for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." And when he said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." And the dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. And Jesus said to them, "Take off his grave clothes and let him go." Yeah, we mourn individually. Mary and Martha, they mourn the loss of their brother. But there's an element where they were mourning collectively as well. This is a picture here of an artist's representation of a Jewish practice called sitting Shiva. And that practice is such that for 7 days, friends and relatives come to the home of the one that is grieving, and they sit there, and they don't throw around platitudes. They feel the grief together. And as they sit and they feel that grief together, they recite what is called the Kaddish. The Kaddish goes, and I won't do it in Hebrew, but "Magnified and sanctified be the great name of God." There's a lot of things we'll never understand. And as long as I know that there are people that are walking with me and beside me, I don't need to understand. I can go ahead and sit in the mystery and in the moment and understand that we're in this together. And so mourning is an individual thing, but it's also a collective thing as well. And as long as we're very careful with our words, as long as we're very careful with our intentions, we can be part of the healing balm that helps that other person lament. Lament is something that we don't like to give other people the permission to do because it makes us uncomfortable. But there's a whole book of the Bible that's talking about lament. It's called the Book of Lamentations. And Jeremiah is the writer, and he, for five chapters, uses this long poem that just continues to remind his people that God is still there. If you really want to be uncomfortable, some parts of the world, I mean, when grief is going on, they rend their clothes and they weep aloud and they march down the street and make a lot of noise as a protest that something has come through the window that is foreign and unwelcome. The entire Book of Lamentations gives voice to collective mourning, and while it memorializes Israel's grief, it gives voice to all of our grief as well. We are seeing the collective mourning of people in Israel and in Palestine every day. And while it might be overwhelming to us, sometimes we need to feel that pain. And we need to remind ourselves that lament is not whining. And we don't need to tell people to get over it. It is the cry of those that see the truth of the world's deepest wounds and the toil that it takes upon the human race. Lament bears witness to all that is not right in the world. I guess grief ultimately unveils what is in our souls. And so where do we find comfort? Blessed are those who mourn, individually or collectively, for they will be comforted. I guess the best I can give to you in this moment is to remind ourselves that Jesus brought the fullness of his humanity into every moment. And he understands what we are going through every moment of every day. Comfort comes in a variety of different ways, but it usually involves someone walking with us through the pain. As I mentioned there, we don't have the ability to take the pain away, do we? But we can help carry it. I guess ultimately, because Jesus is the resurrection and the life, and the promise of resurrection is still held out in front of us, each and every one of us, I need to remind myself that death ends a life, but it does not end a relationship. And to grieve is to love. If you love someone, you're going to grieve. There's no way around it. But we do have hope. And because we have hope, the best thing that you can hold on to is your memory of that person, the memory of the moments that you had together. Your best friend in times of mourning is your memory. A lot of times people, they just want to move on. You got to sit in those moments and in the memory. Because memory is a way of holding on to the things you love, the things you are currently, and the things that you never want to lose. And so memory becomes this aid to us. It becomes our lifeline in many respects. The life of the lost is placed into the memory of the living until the time when memory is merged with loving reunion. I worked on that last line for a long time, because I think that's how we heal. The life of the lost is placed into the memory of the living until the time when our memory is merged with reunion. And that day is coming, my brothers and sisters, right? This life is very short and goes by very quickly. But there is a day when we will no longer need to worry about how life flies by, and we will be in the presence of those that we have lost. Let that be your inner strength. I'm going to ask Emma and Corey to come back up at this time. And I'm going to put the words up on the screen. However, this is really not kind of a sing congregational type of song. But Emma's going to sing it as special music as we close our time. And I'll use the words, okay, so that you can kind of see them as they unfold. So much. What a good reminder that is, that there are times where a song, a person, or a moment gives us a hope that we need to take the next step. Stand with me, please. Let's say this beatitude together in unison. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. We can do a little bit better. Ready? Ready? Blessed are they who mourn, for they shall be comforted. And may God's comfort, may his presence, and may his peace rest upon you. May he lift up his face, and may you see the glory of his love. Amen.